This is Ham Radio Now, episode 258. Wait, I'm struggling to pick one of three titles for this. The first one is 5-Watt Field Day. 5-Watt Field Day. Hang on to that for a second. The second one, second possible title, is Field of Beams. Now, I know that's awesome, right? I don't know why no other ham radio program has latched onto that. And maybe one has, but I did a Google search, not an extensive one. It spent about a minute. Came up with other things that were called Field of Beams, you know, harkening back to the Field of Dreams movie. But they didn't have anything to do with ham radio. There were some that were in physics and a few other things. And there weren't a lot, but I didn't find anything in ham radio. So, wow. It's a good title. I should have used that back when I did the last big field day program, or maybe I'll use it for the next big field day program. It's still coming up. Cindy liked Field of Beams. And then the third possible title is Two Mayors, No Waiting. You'll see why that's a possible title as you watch this program. And you have to be old and you have to have gone to barbershops to understand the reference on that. So, all right. I'm afraid that the words field day have to be in the title of a program like this. So as good as Field of Beams would be, I'm going with 5-Watt Field Day. So here we go. 5-Watt Field Day. So I had grand plans for this field day. I was going to make a circuit around North Carolina. Here's me. Here's me in the Raleigh, North Carolina area. There's a bunch of field day sites that are near me. But I was going to head out Interstate 40 and stop here in Orange County and then here in Alamance County and head over to the Greensboro area and maybe head down I-85, spend the night somewhere around the Charlotte area, see a couple of these, stop in for about an hour or two at each one and, you know, drive in between, come back this direction, catch a couple of these guys, and then back home. But didn't happen. Didn't happen that way. One day before this has not been a good spring and early summer for me health-wise. Came back from Dayton, didn't have any problem at Dayton, but after Dayton, a couple days after Dayton, Cindy started feeling bad. She didn't go to Dayton, so it wasn't the Dayton crud. And then the day after that, I started feeling bad. I had a temperature, sore throat, kind of achy, fever, stuff like that. And that lasted for a long time and kind of interfered with getting programs done and getting some other things happening. And that was back in May. And then it kind of went away, saw the doctor, got some antibiotics, sore throat went away, felt pretty good. But then the day before field day, or the Thursday before field day, the sore throat came back and I wasn't feeling all that good again. Had the 100-degree fever, the energy all disappeared. So I thought, wow, this is going to put a crimp in field day. On Friday, I started feeling better. So that was a 24-hour kind of thing. Came and went pretty quick. But I kind of lost my setup time getting all this equipment ready to go for the field day. So I was kind of afraid that whatever was bothering me would come back. So I scaled things back to just a one day, and I was going to stop at a couple places. So I started with these guys here in Orange County, W4EZ. And let's see, there's their website, the Orange County Radio Amateurs. And this was actually a combined operation. They were working with the Durham FM Association. And so I stopped at that field day site. And then I moved down the road to these guys here in Burlington, Alamance Amateur Radio Association. But first, the first stop was here in Orange County. And I got there about an hour before the beginning of field day. And as I was pulling the equipment out of the car, I was seeing these guys down the road getting something set up. And so I grabbed a camera real quick, didn't have time for the microphones and the tripod or anything, and headed down to see what they were doing. And it looks like they were going to be setting up an antenna.
Gary, you're filming.
Yeah.
Tucker, can you go put your foot on the end of the string there, please?
Yeah.
I don't want to overshoot it. Ryan, looks like we're all there.
Hey, yeah. Gary, how are you?
I'm good. How you doing?
Hold on. Let me roll out the line so it doesn't snag on itself.
Tell me when you're ready.
Clear. And boom!
Now we're there.
Pretty good.
Okay, go get the tennis ball.
I got it.
Okay, pull clear of the tree. Keep pulling. You're good.
Water bottle, huh?
You're good.
So this was a challenging tangle of foliage, but it looked like Steve had a handle on it.
Yeah, don't pull too hard.
I think.
Just kind of look and see how you can kind of walk it around. There's no way to do this.
I see where it's nice. Gracefully.
Think that's low enough for you to get with the pole? Yeah, we brought it down enough. So, Gary, you know, last year we scored third place nationwide.
I was going to ask about that.
People wonder, how do you do that?
Bob.
So the first thing, W3AO, you're not going to beat them.
Yeah,
so W6IY. Maybe we won't beat them either, but we're going to try real hard. And so everybody goes, wow, man, how do you do that? You guys were nowhere a couple of years ago. Now look at this. Well, that's because it's harder. And one, two, three, four, five, six. No, leave the water. I want the water bottle on. Don't let it go. Okay, I want it to not wrap around anything. So I gotta.
Are you looking at what you're trying to drag it?
I am.
Good luck.
I know.
Sounds like my dad and I. So are we clear to?
You can let go.
All right.
My father would say, "Hey, get you."
Yeah. What kind of clown are you? Okay, here it comes. Watch out. Done. Okay, so what did you learn about counterweights? This is the cheapest, most effective one you've ever... Alright. Okay, so see if you can't recover that cord on the reel if you save the reel. Brian, did you save the reel? Okay, well, there you go. So what we have now is we have this end of the support line, and that end of the support line is in that tree, and now this one's here in the street, which is where we want it. And this is going to be used to pull up a heavier rope, which will be the common point of support for two 80-meter dipoles, one that runs east-west along the street here, the other one that'll run north-south over to a tree over there. At night, of course, at this height, those dipoles will just start to have an effective pattern 90 degrees off the plane of the antenna. We'll be able to switch between them. At 5 watts, this matters.
It does.
No, I didn't practice.
He didn't practice. So I left those guys to finish setting up their antenna. And tell you what, I'm going to switch over to back to their website. And they've got this map of their operation. It's a Google map, and they just kind of drew their stuff on it, and it's very cool. These are the antennas that Steve was putting up, these two 80-meter antennas. Almost perpendicular to each other. And then here's the rest of the site. So this will give you a sense of the operation as I talk to the guy in charge. And I was standing right here when I talked to him. So let's go see. So hold that microphone up close. We'll get some of the debris off of it.
Got it. Okay.
And although it's not real noisy here, there's something missing from this field day site.
Ah. Of course. Well, that's because we're a an 8 alpha battery operation. So
all battery.
Almost all battery. You might hear a compressor in the background for some air conditioning and such, but all the transceivers will be operated off battery only.
Okay. Let's roll back to where we should start.
Sure.
But I had to get the joke in.
Gotcha.
No generators. It's quiet. It's
yes,
very
indeed.
Very quiet.
Indeed.
Now, we're going to assume that the people who are watching this program mm-hmm. are hams. They know yes. what field day is.
So absolutely.
We'll drill in on some of the details. But let's start with who are you and where are we and who's this group?
Well, I'm Dave Snyder, call signs W4SAR, and I'm the coordinator for this field day operation, which is actually a joint operation of two clubs, the Orange County Radio Amateurs and the Durham FM Association. And we started
in North Carolina.
In North Carolina.
Because we're worldwide.
Exactly. Right now we're in Hillsborough, North Carolina. But the two clubs partnered several years ago, and ever since we did that, we've been just rocketing up the charts in terms of the rankings for field day.
Okay, so you're planning 8 Alpha.
Correct.
Which, we'll explain a few things. That's yep. 8 stations.
8 HF stations and 1 VHF station.
All right, so. The VHF station is a freebie.
So indeed.
Eight yes. HF stations.
Correct.
But battery operated.
Correct, yes.
And so that puts you in a sort of a separate category.
It does indeed. And 5 watts maximum output. So that really helps us with the multipliers. And I think that's what helped put us in the top of the rankings. Last year, out of more than 2,500 participating stations in North America, we ranked number 3.
What's the call sign? Because that's what people will look
Whiskey
up.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu.
W4EZ. EZ. That's
yes, sir.
Easy. You got an easy button here.
Exactly.
I have not done all mm-hmm. of my homework. I know that, because mm-hmm. I live just down the road.
Right.
I know that you guys end up in the top 10 box often.
We have
all
since the
time.
Past few years, yeah.
Yeah. And are you the number 1 battery operated station? I guess
not
with all the different categories, it's kind of hard to say.
Yeah, last year number 3 was the highest that we've attained. In the Roanoke division we were number 1, and in North Carolina we were number 1.
Okay, so you were if you were number 3,
yes.
You were the top ranking battery station. At 5
no,
watts.
Not quite.
Well there was only number 2 and number 1. So
that's very true. Actually,
we know who
no.
those guys are.
My apologies. There was one other station in California that just squeaked past us. They're on battery.
On battery.
But number
okay.
1 was not battery.
All right.
Yeah.
And battery is, but the rules require 5 watts? Because you can run more power with batteries.
You can, but
by
keeping it 5 watts or under, you get that 5 times multiplier for each QSO. And
okay,
I think
so
that's
the
really
rules allow for higher power battery.
You can.
If you
can.
Want.
Yes.
But you guys stay at 5 watts.
Correct.
And that does what for you?
You get a 5 times multiplier for each QSO that you make. So
okay.
that helps. So for instance, I'm running a digital station. There's 2 points for each of those QSOs. So with each one of those I do under battery, that's 10 points apiece. So that adds up.
All right. With 8 stations, you're not going to be all CW.
No.
Or even CW and digital. Which are the high scoring?
Definitely the CW ops are the big guns here. They'll pull in the most points. And then we have several phone stations operating. And I'll have a multi-band digital station
right.
working as well.
Look at my watch. It's about 20 minutes until the start. You got some stations on the air. What's it sound like out there now?
It's pretty quiet. I hear the propagation's a bit challenging this year. I mean, they saw no sunspots.
Yeah,
so.
we're on the downward slide of the old
yeah.
sunspot cycle.
Yeah, so I think especially the higher frequency bands are going to be very challenging this time around. So hopefully those of us working the lower bands will help pull things through a bit.
But you've got stations dedicated to those bands anyway. With 8
yeah.
stations, how are they
absolutely.
Split up?
Well, the CW operators have 3 operating stations in there, but they're working all the CW bands. So a couple of stations will flip-flop on from higher to lower bands following the propagation.
Okay, but just 3 dedicated to CW?
At one time, any one time, yes.
Because yeah. I'm surprised you don't do more.
Yeah, well, it was last year we used to have 80 CW sitting on its own, you know, at the end of a very long wire out in the corner there, but they decided to bundle them all together this year and use that nice air-conditioned emergency vehicle there.
Yeah, I would.
Sure.
So that's the buzz I hear in the background. It's
yeah.
not quite totally silent.
Yeah, yeah. There's a little yeah. bit of one compressor working there for the air conditioning.
And that's legal.
Yes. As long as it's auxiliary equipment, as long as the transceivers themselves are on battery power. we are good.
And tell me a little bit about these battery setups. Did they all get charged prior to field day and you just kind of drain them? Are you doing any other power?
The only permissible means of recharging them would be you can't use commercial mains, of course, and you cannot use a fuel-driven generator. So really the only feasible method we have here for recharging any would be solar panels, and it's rather overcast today, so.
Yeah.
Well, I think what batteries we have
will... Check the cloud situation. Well, there's a little spot of blue. Quick, grab some solar while you can.
Yeah, shove it in there. So basically, what batteries we have on site are pretty much will have to carry us through. But we're well supplied, so I have a feeling we'll do all right.
What kind of battery capacity does each station have?
Each of them usually has several hundred amp hours of battery capacity.
And at 5 watts, that's good.
Yeah, that should work. Yeah. And for the digital station, also the computer we're using to drive the radio, that too must be on the same battery system.
Okay. So. But you could run air conditioning, lighting.
Yep.
Lighting can be off
fans,
of some other.
Yeah, fans, all that can be done off power drops. And we do have a few scattered around here for that auxiliary equipment.
Yeah, but generally not generators.
No. No, the generators are also very noisy. As you remarked, it's pretty quiet here now.
So generators can be quiet, but there's always,
because
hams are cheap.
Yes.
No, so there's always some ham that brings the unmuffled.
Yes.
So every field they said except for this one and the other battery guys are going to
indeed,
have it.
Indeed.
Strategy.
Strategy as well. As one of the CW operators puts it, AIS, which means something in seat. So
you can say that.
Yeah.
We're on YouTube.
Okay.
We can get away with a certain amount and still call ourselves
family-friendly. To bowdlerize it, we could say butt in chair.
Yeah.
BIC. Okay. So basically try to keep the chairs filled. We'll look at what the propagation is and work those bands that are producing well. And because... Yes, we're being competitive, but we also don't want to lose the sight of the fact that we have some new hams here, and we want to have fun with it.
So I was going to say, is it all 100% blood and guts, go for maximum everything, squeak everything last point out?
It's a mix. We do have some true competitors here, some very experienced contesters, but we also have people who just like to be out and do this, experiment, try new antenna systems, and... And also, we actually have some new hams. This may be their first day actually operating.
I was looking at the ARRL locator. I didn't see a go-to station listed. Are you going to do one?
Not this year. It's been a little difficult for us to have enough resources to maintain that and run all the stations here.
Because that's more points.
I agree.
In addition to a place for those folks to go that are limited experience.
Yeah, I agree.
Dragging down... Mm-hmm. The rest of the operation, because I'm sure you got a few folks that get a little anxious.
We've tried doing GOTA in the past, and it was hard to keep enough people staffed on it to keep it going. So basically, if we have brand new hams, we kind of welcome to the phone stations, which will be easier for them to get accustomed to working. I know one or two new hams who are computer savvy. They're going to work with me on digital. And if we have some who by now have gotten some CW experience, then they're welcome to try a hand in at the CW stations.
What digital modes do you try to operate?
Virtually all the contacts are on PSK31. You
so
still
RIDI,
see some...
RIDI has fallen off?
RIDI, not much at all. I might take a peek there to see if anybody's out there, but PSK pretty much rules it right now.
Yeah, because you can see all the stations that are on one display. And
exactly.
Just go bing, bing, bing.
Yeah, exactly. I've got macros set up on my program so I can do the exchanges very quickly.
On the... let's start with the CW guys.
Mm-hmm.
Do they try to hold a frequency and run?
I think it's a mix.
Let's explain that terminology, because even though it's mostly ham, some won't understand. Run is you stay in one spot and try to get people to call you. At 5 watts, that could be a challenge.
Yeah, That's why I think primarily at 5 watts we try hunt and pounce. We look around, try to work stations. If there's a heavy pile up and they can't hear us, we'll pass on that, look for someone else.
And then antenna going up behind you over your head.
As long as it's not coming this way.
Not so far.
Yeah.
But I'll show everybody what...
Yeah.
You maybe can hear that in the background a little bit.
But like I said, we do mostly hunt and pounce. If there's heavy pile-ups, you leave that station alone, come back to it later. If we find gaps out there where we might be able to set up and try run, we do that.
Because run is supposed to be the contact generator.
Yes.
If you can get people to keep calling, then you get a much higher rate per hour.
Exactly.
But with 5 watts,
that
can be hard.
So that basically needs you to be able to find a relatively clear piece of frequency getting QRM from each side.
Yeah,
on field day especially.
Maybe 15 meters.
Yeah. So basically, they just have to be reactive, see what's working best, and go with hunt and pounce or doing a run.
Okay, same thing goes with PSK-31. Impressive that you can do so well with stations not able to run.
Yeah.
They must be really good at search and pounce.
I think we got some pretty good people there doing that.
On phone, there's another term for run. It's called park and bark.
Yeah.
This is the first year I've heard anybody use that phrase.
It's a good one, though.
So what do they call it on CW?
That I don't know. I'm not much of a CW operator, so
I'll have to ask the CW guys. What's their equivalent of park and bark?
Sit and click. I don't know.
I'm trying to think of what else you can reveal about your strategy that would allow a competitor to move in. You don't want to do that, do you?
Yeah. Well, actually, we've done okay. And like I said, getting a lot of operators here and relief operators is an important thing.
Yeah. Especially you're drawn from two clubs, both in the greater scheme of things, fairly large clubs.
Yep. And a lot of us are dual members. They're members of both organizations.
So, yeah, these towns are kind of side by side. We're in what they call a research triangle area. It's Raleigh, Durham, Chapel Hill.
Pretty much, yeah.
So Orange County is Chapel Hill.
Right.
Durham FM is... Durham FM.
Durham FM Association.
So those guys can only operate FM.
Right. they own quite a few of the repeaters around the area, so that's...
No sideband or CW for those guys.
No, not quite.
They can.
They can, yeah.
Because my first field days were with the club in Chicago, the Chicago FM Club.
Right.
Yeah, and when I brought out my TR-4, most of those guys were like, what is this strange device?
Mm-hmm.
It's sideband.
Uh-huh.
Sideband. Sidebands are bad on FM.
Right.
Okay, but that's who they are.
Yeah.
Probably started way back then, too.
And of course, the other piece of the puzzle here is the social aspect, so... sometimes the people just want to get together here, and maybe the operating is the prime draw, but getting together and socializing with all the other hams that they know and inviting friends over, that's a big aspect of it.
Right.
And food, of course.
of course, most important part of field.
Yeah, we had a good barbecue here last night, a potluck barbecue, which we had more than 50 people attending, and we'll be dining well tonight and breakfast tomorrow morning.
Do you do any of the other extra point generators, publicity?
Yes, we did that.
I don't think I count.
We got some of the new ones. We got we have a Facebook page up for field day here. So that's the social media points.
Oh, cool.
We have a safety officer on site.
I didn't know that existed.
Yeah, it was a new one this
safety
year.
Safety officer is extra points?
Yeah, 100 points for having a dedicated safety officer.
He should be standing there behind you doing something with this antenna raising that's going on.
Okay, he's probably eyeballing it.
Yeah,
I'm the other safety officer, too, and I got my back to them.
They're not, actually they've come back down, so I'm not sure what the story is there.
And the other, some of the other points, we already had a visit from one of our served agencies, so we have that.
I think I saw the official vehicle heading out as I was pulling in.
Yes, indeed. And I believe the mayor of Hillsborough is going to make an attempt to be here, so we will have at least one elected official.
So tell me who you are.
I am Tom Stevens. I have the privilege of serving as the mayor of Hillsborough, North Carolina, right in the heart of Orange County, which is where we're sitting right now, out in the woods in beautiful Orange County on a warm and a little bit humid day, but it's a beautiful place.
Could be worse.
Yeah, it actually is pretty good weather than what we might be facing.
You're not a ham.
I am not. I am an elected official and certainly interested in what folks in our community are doing. This is the second or third time I've come out for the field day to see what's happening and looked at the Morse code guys and see the folks here working the ham on the 5 watts and their low wattage, and they're explaining this to me.
So how much are you getting? Are you very technical?
Not a whole lot, except for my iPhone.
So you're an average person.
Just an average person, right.
Yeah. And at three visits, they're going to start wondering why you aren't getting a ham license yet.
That is fair enough. It's a lot of fun. It looks like everyone's really enjoying it.
What are you taking in of what you're seeing here? What have they explained to you?
Well, one thing, it's clear that it's connecting to folks all around the country. It is preparation for a potential emergency, and you know what I know from watching our fire department, police department, back in even my teenage days when I was in Civil Air Patrol, it's being prepared for emergencies. It's important, and you do that by practicing.
Yep.
And so looking at them using the equipment, trying it out in a competition, but also seeing how it works, and basically it's practice, 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 and hope you don't need it, but when you do, it's there ready for you.
Hillsborough is a fairly small town.
Hillsborough's a small town of about 6,500. It's a very historic town. It's got the only standing house for a sign of the Declaration of Independence, and a place where General Johnson had his headquarters when he surrendered to Sherman, and it's also one of the beginnings of NASCAR, but it's just a little town.
You're hearing from the Chamber of Commerce now.
You're hearing from the Chamber of Commerce, but it's a great little place to visit. But out in Orange County, very rural area, wonderful farms, old dairy farm area, and of course, if there was an emergency conditions, this is kind of where folks would be.
Yeah. Now, Hillsborough probably doesn't have its own emergency operating center. You got police department.
We have a police department, and we certainly have our EOC
that we have.
And connected with the county, and certainly have other folks who are involved on an emergency basis. And So we try to be prepared for emergencies.
It's a closet in the basement of City Hall, right?
A little bit better than that. Actually, we have an EOC that had been in our police department. It's now at another one of our facilities.
Do you have hams there?
I believe we do, but I should have a more affirmative answer for that than I actually do.
Yeah, well, that's what we're trying to get people to do it, and getting ham radio recognized and participating continuously is always difficult. Some areas dig right in, some areas don't. So these guys are going to be beating on your door, hopefully before next field day.
Excellent.
Are you impressed with the operation?
I am.
Of course he is.
These folks know what they're doing. Like I said, they're enjoying it. They're having a good time. But you can tell they're practicing what they know. They're sharing information. They're letting folks like me kind of in on what's happening. And so I appreciate that.
All right. We'll see you next year.
You bet. Thank you.
Or maybe before. Maybe before. You'll have a ham license by next year, right? We have to say that.
We always say that. Well, we'll chat about that next year. Yes, absolutely. That would be a fun thing to do. I should put that on the list.
Someone's going to try to grab a satellite when it comes by overhead, and
The satellite. Actually, that's what those antennas look like that they're setting up there. Is that just for one contact, or are they going to try to do something?
You could always try to do more, but all you need is one to get that that bonus.
Yeah.
And then, of course, because we're 100% emergency power, each one of the HF stations gets 100 points. So that's a big one right there.
All right. Is this a public location officially?
Yeah, it's private property, but we'll have some signage up, and on the social media page, we've given directions to the site.
So. Do you often get just general people wandering by? We're not on a main road anyplace.
You get the occasional one that comes here thinking it's a yard sale, and then they realize, something else is going on.
I'm not sure what public locations get you. I did field day one year on the Capitol, North Carolina Capitol grounds in Raleigh.
Right.
Raleigh's the Capitol.
Mm-hmm.
And it turns out, and it's downtown Raleigh.
Yes.
Downtown Raleigh's dead on the weekends.
Okay.
At least it was back then. This was 2002. They're getting some more stuff going on now.
Yeah.
So we got a few folks that wandered by, but I was kind of expecting, lines out the door of the tents.
Yeah, you're thinking Raleigh, but no, well.
I also expected legislators or maybe the governor would stop by, but it was the weekend, wasn't anybody there.
Oh, well.
We got one TV station that saw our antenna as they were going to another story and stopped and said, what are you guys doing here? You got permission to be here? And I did, actually.
Yes, we do.
Yeah.
And then I think one of the other points we have is natural power, and the way we accomplish that is we have a battery that was solely charged with solar panels, and we use that to work some CW contacts.
And that took, what, 6-8 months? So you started at the end of last field day?
I think it depends on what kind of weather we had.
How long does it really take?
I think
also
it depends.
Also depends on the size of the solar panels.
Yeah, and it doesn't have to be a very big battery, because I think you have to get 5 QSOs, and we'd usually do at least 10 on CW, which is no problem at 5 watts.
So. No bicycle with a generator?
Oh, I actually think we did that 1 year, and we had kids able to work it for
us.
Yes,
you went young folks. The interns.
Yes, yeah. But, I think we get most of the points covered. So.
We're going back up.
All right.
We're going back
good,
up.
As long as it's
still fairly vertical.
Oh, good.
There's folks hanging on to the guy wires.
Uh-huh.
They seem to understand what they're doing.
They do talk to each other. So
we're measuring for, you can look back there if you want.
All
we're
right.
Measuring for verticalness. We're leveling.
Ah.
Safety officers watching. Watch out, guys. Are they all being safe?
Well,
I don't see any hard
somewhat.
Hats.
Yeah, that's the one problem. Yeah, we might not get those points anyway.
Right.
Okay.
Oh, now you're concerned. But you got to stay back in here. Stay in camera.
Nope.
I don't have a camera operator back
right,
there, so if we wander off, then then there's I end up with an empty picture.
Sure.
So anything else that people out there need to know?
Well, like I said, we do it for competition. It's also a disaster drill, so it's a lot of good practice for those times when we really do lose power for an extended period.
Is field day really an MCOM exercise?
I think in many ways it is. Like I said, there is the fun and social aspect of it as well, but we're getting used to putting up these towers. These are temporary structures, so, I mean, if a bad enough disaster struck, maybe a lot of our home stations would not be there, would not be available. So learning how to put one together on the field and learning how to operate for an extended period without having the power grid working, that's all valuable skills to learn. And if you have a problem with your emergency setup, well, we sure find out trying to set up here what the problems were and try to get fixed by 2 o'clock.
So I guess the other half of that equation then is do people ever actually take advantage of what they've learned here?
I think so. Yeah, I believe they do. Yeah. Certainly, they know and bring lots of batteries.
I did one time. I did.
Yeah.
I got a call out to a hurricane that kind of devastated eastern North Carolina. Mm-hmm. Our part here in East Central was spared, but you go 100 miles east of here and things were pretty much flattened.
Right.
So I headed out there, and the things I had practiced on field day, generator, didn't haul a lot of
I don't
batteries.
Think we're worrying about the rules then.
setting up dipoles and stuff. I brought my field day dipole. I didn't have to set it up because I ended up doing everything on VHF. But all those skills, they did come into use. But I kind of wonder how many people that's really the case, or are they just here to eat the barbecue and drink beer and make contacts?
I think they're here for the full experience, really, because you had to see how hard they were working to get those towers up yesterday. And some people experiment with different antennas at home and put them to use. I mean, over that pond there, we got a 40-meter beam antenna, a wire beam for working phone.
Yeah, wires don't show up on video very well.
No, unfortunately, not very well, but I actually had to use my kayak to ferry lines across the pond to
I should have
help
been here
get
for
it
that.
Set up. Yeah, yeah.
Well, now you're acing me out of my own show. I guess take a step back there.
Take a step back this way.
There you
okay,
go.
Gotcha.
Yeah, we got to stop from this wandering. I need to geolocate you. And then the last question is it a contest?
People say officially it's not a contest, but I think in many ways it is. We kind of look at the rankings, so that part of the competitiveness comes out there.
If you keep score,
yes,
it's a contest.
I think so. And certainly we are trying to accumulate all those pints and everything. So I think the points are the incentive to try to be as efficient as you can.
There's an emergency exercise in the fall.
Yes.
Called the simulated emergency test.
Yep.
You don't get all these people out there for that.
No, I think, but a good number of the people we see here, I think, actually do participate in that.
But you guys are different. You guys are an odd. There's other clubs like you.
Yeah.
But most clubs, I think, are not.
Okay.
Most clubs are more social. You guys seem to really dig into things.
We do. We got a lot of really brilliant folks here that really know their way around electronics and some common sense jury rigging. You know, all that comes together for this kind of thing.
And if you can be number three in field aid nationwide with 5 watts,
yes,
that's doing something.
Indeed.
Thank you, Dave.
Indeed. My hat's off to all these guys. They're great to work with. And gals.
Right. Someone's- this is Wilson Lamb, Whiskey 4 Bravo Oscar Hotel. My father's call originally issued in 1932.
What I wanted to add to the collection of conversations I've got here is with just 5 watts, antennas, which are always important, become even more important.
Very much so. With 5 watts, we are down in the noise for most people, but a good beam at a decent height, 30, 40 feet, is probably 10 dB above their average dipole in the trees. So that puts us up in the 50-watt class.
So I'm seeing a lot of beams here.
We have been practicing for several years. Various ones bring towers, and we pull them up with tractors and winches, and we have a safety man who keeps an eye on things. And
he wasn't doing much of a job back when I was talking to Dave. Because it was Dave, and he wasn't paying any attention.
Was he raising a tower?
No. There was a tower going up over his head behind him.
Oh, well, we were supposed to stay out of the way. We've never hurt anybody. This year, I think we have more than ever, about 6 or so. And it's fun. We worked all day yesterday, very hard, and then had some barbecue.
So part of the, you were telling me that before that the main reason for 5 watts is the bonus points, or the multiplier, because every contact gets so big. But
whether we make more contacts than we would with 100 watts is not clear, but the multiplier is nice, and we've never computed. Yeah. But
well, I've looked at your scores, and your raw QSO count is way below the guys that you are up there competing with, but your points count is competitive.
That's our multiplier.
Yeah, it's the multiplier.
5 watts, batteries.
And the beams get you there.
And, well, we couldn't do it without the beams. No, we'd be way down the list without the beams. On 20, when 20 is working, we run almost continuously. Nearly everybody comes back first try. Most of the rest come back second try. If we don't get them on 3, we typically give up. But it's 80% or more first try, and that's pretty good for 5 watts.
Is sideband much more of a challenge?
It is, and honestly, I don't go up there very much. I'm pretty intense in the CW rig, but they work quite a few. 20 meters gets 500 or 600, and I think 40 sideband may get 150, 200, so they make significant points. But CW has its usual 9 dB or so advantage, and that helps.
Dave was telling me that you can't hold a frequency and run very well with 5 watts.
No. We get some runs. People have run for 20 minutes, 25 minutes. It's unusual because somebody with more power who isn't hearing us can hop on and make it unusable. But we get occasional runs. It's not the main thing.
So you become experts at search and bounce.
I really don't try running very much. You know, if somebody calls, I'll work them. But my usual strategy is 1 CQ and then tweak the dial, and I move up 200, 300, 400 hertz and try again.
How long will you beat on someone who's not answering you and answering everybody
else? I never
else?
Call more than 3 calls. Three tries.
And then you'll move up. Figure yeah. You'll try them again later.
Yeah. Or not get them, because in the time I'm missing them, I can work through other people.
Yeah.
It's we have some intense contesters, but as a whole, it's only moderate. So we don't do everything that somebody might, but most of us take it moderately seriously.
Now, we're getting up there in years. You going to spend all night here?
I live here.
Oh, this is your place. So
it's pretty easy for me. We have some campers. Some will simply sit up all night. Some will go home and sleep. Some of each. Yeah, I'm 74. I got my ticket in 57. And so I'm getting up there experience-wise. But we do go all night with somebody. 20 meters, even 20 gets very thin. There are times when we've worked everybody on the band.
Yeah. So the frequencies that do run all night long, 40 and 80. And do you guys do 160 here?
Not 160.
All right. Yeah. 40 and 80, no beams.
But so some pretty high dipoles.
So you work the dipoles as hard as you can.
Yes. And when 80 is good, we make a lot of contacts. I have not worked 80 seriously at night. I haven't.
Yeah. The noise level is real high.
You may notice on the A4 here that we have the 40-meter kit. So we do have one element rotary on 40. And it's a little worse than a dipole, but at least you can point it where you want it. So it's better than a dipole in the wrong direction.
All right. So the bottom line is, if you're going to do 5 watts, you need beams.
The club used to do a 5-watt field day with low dipoles in the trees, and they had fun. Now, I don't know the scores. It was before my time, but it was not competitive.
Before your time, that would have been the 1930s.
Well, I mean my time in Okra. Okay. 10 years ago, they were casual low dipoles in the trees, even low trees, like 20 feet, 30 feet. And they had fun, but we're not as competitive, not competitive like we are now. So it's what you make it, you know. One guy in a tent with a dipole can have a barrel of fun. That's a wonderful thing about ham radio.
Yeah, we're not telling everybody they've got to be competitive.
You do it for fun and put in the effort you want and feel good.
Absolutely, Wilson. All right. Well, thank you, Dave and Wilson, and also Hillsborough Mayor Tom Stevens. That is Mayor number one. Two mayors, no waiting. In that interview, you got a couple of snippets of Bruce Meyer and one LN expertly operating 40-meter CW. I shot about 8 minutes of Bruce operating, and in that time he ran, as we talked about with Dave. He called CQ for a few minutes. He did some search and pounce for a few minutes. I thought you might enjoy watching all of the video that I shot and seeing what it's really like on that end of operating with 5 watts. So I'm going to put that at the end of the show. I also shot a bunch of video of one of the phone stations. It's in this trailer. It was being operated by Greta Lamb, KM4LCW, with Brian Schoenfeld, K5QZI. We saw him back setting up the dipoles with Steve. He was helping out in logging. Well, things there didn't go so well. Remember how we talked about how 5 watts is especially tough on phone. So I'm going to call this instructive, a learning opportunity, watching that operation. And I'm going to put it at the end of the show because it takes a while. I hung around longer than I expected at the Orange County operation, several hours. So I'm only going to have time for one more place to go. But as I was leaving, I ran into Steve, KZ1X, once again. And guess what he was doing?
Yeah. I was going to say, are you still trying to get this antenna up?
Well, it's multiple antennas, and it's multiple complications, and it's the challenge of trying to dance it around that 6-meter Yagi.
And it's 80 meters anyway, right? So you got
two 80-meter dipoles at right angles to each other at reasonable height. And so the goal, of course, is to get them off the ground high enough so that they start to become directive. And if they're directive, then it's a bonus because you've got two to work with. And this is, you know, people, Gary, this is where people will go like, well, guys are QRP, no wonder. This is a hell of a lot of work. And and the answer is no, it's the way to build an effective station, even if you're not running QRP.
You'll just do even better if you got more power.
Yes, exactly right.
And so, you got till sundown, so
yeah,
exactly. You got some time.
Well, I'm eating into operating time because I'm one of the few guys here that can operate CW.
Ah.
So, now, I could be on 20.
In that case, pull harder.
Yeah, pull harder. Well, now Rob Katz over there is W4OV, is pretty big contester, and he's on the other end of this column and some of the shots. And he lives in a pretty wooded area, and he's very, very familiar with installing and servicing antennas in a situation like this. So some of it, we've got good equipment, and we also have a lot of seasoned operators. Plus, this is our 24th year doing this. And most of us are still here. We haven't killed each other yet.
Only one
now,
day a year.
You notice that a lot of us have a lot less hair than we started with. I don't know how that happened.
Yeah, me either, Steve. I've got the same problem. So now I'm running out of time, but I could squeeze in that one more operation. So I'm going to head down the road. We were over here in Orange County. We're going to head down here to Alamance Amateur Radio Club. That's these guys here. And I ran into an old, actually a young friend.
I know who you are. They don't know who you are. Who are you?
I know who you are. I'm Christopher Tate, KJ4UBL PIO for the Alamance Amateur Radio Club here in Burlington, North Carolina.
The first time I talked to you, you were about that tall. Who are you?
I'm Christopher, KJ4UBL.
Actually, you're famous. Everybody knows who you are. Here in North Carolina, you are a public information officer.
Yes.
You get on TV all the time.
Yes. I've got my general class license. I'm a skywarn spotter. I'm a public information officer. Look at me.
And so now you're like 30 years old. Hold the mic up close. These guys are making a lot of noise.
All right, all right.
Okay, so where are we?
We are in the middle of our field day operation here in Burlington. Behind me, we've got Tony, K4QE, and his son Brian working on our GOTA station. And looks like he's in the middle of a CUSA, which is quite exciting. We've had
awesome.
We've had a fairly decent operation today. The bands have been a little quiet here in the Old North State, but overall, it's chugging along.
And there's another station over there behind you?
Yeah, behind me we have our digital station currently being manned by Garner, KK4CLY.
And outside there's more going on.
Yes, outside we have a trailer that that Alamance County has loaned to us for use of the event. That trailer is currently housing our CW station.
So what's the class?
Alamance County, or the Alamance Amateur Radio Club, is operating 3 Foxtrot this year.
Okay, so Foxtrot is not a real common class.
That's right.
So how does that work? What's the deal?
So Foxtrot designates that we're at an emergency operations center or some other sort of established emergency management facility.
Okay. And so what are we at? Is this an official EOC?
Yes, this is the Alamance County Fire Marshal's Office and the Alamance County Emergency Operations Center.
And does that mean you can operate commercial power, or are you guys still on generators?
So we're allowed to use commercial power and, you know, existing infrastructure, but for a short period of field day, we're required to go off the grid and use generators. And if my memory serves me right, that period's fairly close to an hour.
Okay. So, I mean, this is an EOC. It's probably got plenty of generator power.
Right. And all they have to do is run to the back and flip a switch, and poof, we're on batteries.
Yeah. Let's go short out the mains and see if it's still working.
We should.
Yeah, you're not going to do that, are you?
I might try it.
Now that I planted the seed.
I might go try that.
Okay, so you, the GOTA stations are free. So you've got the digital, phone.
CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day, Kilo 4 Echo Golf, K4EG, calling CQ Field Day.
Let me do the count of your total 3. The GOTA is free.
That's
the
right.
The digital's not free.
The digital is not free. That does count as one of our 3 main stations.
So 2 of your 3 are in here.
Right.
And in the trailer
is
a single
outside.
CW station.
Yes.
And with the only guy in the county who knows how to operate CW.
That's what they want to claim, but that's not the truth.
Not by a long shot.
Okay.
There's one or two other guys.
I'm trying
maybe
to get you in trouble here. I'm doing my best.
Oh, I get it.
So I ran into your mayor outside.
Yes, Mayor Baltudis.
What were you just looking at?
We were looking at the operations going on over here for amateur radio field day. We got to see all 4 stations that are operating today and learned a little more about all the different ways that you can communicate over the airwaves and how much information you can communicate all around the world.
There is going to be a quiz. Did you take notes?
No, we didn't.
But fortunately, they'll do this again next year, so you'll be able to come back and try it one more time. How long have you been mayor? You look pretty young.
Been mayor going on 7 months. Just got elected this past year. And I'm the youngest mayor ever in Burlington, North Carolina.
Awesome. How old are you?
30 years old.
Okay, you're an old man. You're
I just look younger than I am.
You look like you're 22.
You're almost
31. Yeah. All right. Was this your first exposure to ham radio, or had you seen anything of it before?
I've seen a little bit at Maker Faires, and got a little bit of a preview when I was in Boy Scouts. But this was my first time actually getting on the radio at the guest station.
They put you on the air?
Yeah.
Did you make some contacts?
We made some contacts up in New Hampshire.
Cool. Yeah. So what do you think of this ham radio thing?
It's impressive. There's a lot of different pieces that go into decoding what you're hearing over the airwaves. And it's amazing how a fine-tuned ear can pick up all the information out there.
So I was telling the Hillsboro mayor he needs to get his ham license now. I got to put the same pressure on you. By next field day, I want you licensed and on the air, okay?
All right. Well, we'll try and fit that into my mayoral schedule.
That's a political promise. Yeah. All right. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Gary.
Did you arrange for that?
Yes. I spoke to the Burlington City Council a few weeks ago and presented them with my annual invitation to come out to field day, since we get the 100 bonus points for elected officials coming out.
You do that in person?
Yes, I do.
You don't just send an email to somebody?
Well, we do both, actually. Every year in May, usually in May, I go to the Burlington City Council meeting and the Alamance County Commissioners meeting and present my invitation to them, inviting them out to field day.
How do they react? Well, they sent the mayor, so.
Yeah.
Who's only about 15 minutes older than you are, I think.
Well, usually I've always gotten a very, very positive response. They're always glad to come out and see what we do and how we serve the community. So I'm always glad to show them around and let them see what we do on a day-to-day basis.
Now, how do you wangle getting the city's or the county's big MCOM trailer out there, right? That's not the club's.
That is not the club's, much as some of us wish it was, myself included. It's air conditioned. It's
so
nice.
Evidently you got pretty good ties with emergency management to get this facility, to get that trailer.
You're absolutely right. We're actually good friends with all of the fire marshals, several of whom have moved on to other ventures. But we did a special licensing class for them to get them licensed, since they had expressed interest in obtaining their licenses. And they've been so gracious to allow us to use their facility and even their giant, nicely air-conditioned trailer that has a TV in it, too.
Air conditioning is good.
Yeah.
So did some of them get licenses? They got call
signs? Actually, every one of them, if I'm remembering correctly, did at least get their tech, and I think a couple of them have moved on to general.
So they've gotten more interested than just the passing barely meet the minimum. They're actually interested.
Thankfully, they have, and we're really glad that's the case.
Because, yeah, you know, we hear MCOM folks, emergency management, you know, they're encouraged by the hams and probably by their bosses to get a ham license, but you always wonder if they're going to take the next step and actually do anything. It's cool that these guys are.
And that's exactly what they've done, is they've taken that next step and used their knowledge and built upon that to get their amateur radio licenses.
Okay. I was down the road, the last field aid site a couple hours ago in Orange County.
Ah.
Those guys are operating 5-watt battery.
Yeah.
And they'll probably be in the top 10. Last year they were number 3 with 5 watts and a battery. Where do you guys end up?
Let's see. Last year we were 5th in, if I remember right, we were 2 Foxtrot last year, and we came in 5th in that category nationally.
So that's not bad.
Thankfully,
so
not.
Would you describe this as a blood and guts contesting type field day operation, or more of a laid back? I saw the steaks going out to the barbecue.
Yeah, dinner. I noticed dinner was cooking a little while ago, and I'm glad for it.
So this is more of a laid back, just kind of everyone has a good time, or
yeah, for the Alamance Amateur Radio Club, at least it's quite a social event. You know, catch up, you know, toss some ideas around, and everybody gather around a handful of radios and see if we can talk to some people.
Yeah. So if you don't come in first, nobody really cares.
Well, it's always nice, but that's not our principal goal of field day. It's, you know, more of us making sure that we know what we're doing and how to do it should we have a disaster in the area.
I was going to say, I asked those guys 2 questions. The first one was, I don't remember what order I asked it in. One of them was, is field day an effective emergency communications exercise?
I think it is, for us at least. It gives us a very valuable opportunity to ensure that we can communicate effectively and efficiently if, you know, normal communications are crippled. It also gives us a chance to demonstrate to emergency management how we work as a group when the need arises.
Yeah, that's the theory. I'm kind of wondering what the reality is. Does it really work out that way? Can people take what they learned today and carry it on to something serious if they have to?
Absolutely. Thankfully, we haven't had any serious events in our area in the last little while, but we had an ice storm, I believe it was going on 2 years ago now, that caused a lot of power outages and several hundred trees in the area to fall, and that resulted in a lot of property damage. Because the phone network, or the power networks, were failing, the cellular network was having a hard time or was overloaded, so we were able to go out and complete damage assessments and examine, you know, the situation in and around some of the rural areas of Alamance County, because it's not all Burlington, it's not all Grand. There's a lot of farmland and a lot of woods and isolated houses.
I've always thought in the major metropolitan areas, the infrastructure is pretty robust. You know, the hams might not have that big a job to do, even in the worst situations. But in a rural county like this, yeah, things can fall apart pretty quick.
Yeah.
Not that we're in a location that looks like it's about to fall apart anytime soon. This is pretty nice.
Yeah, thankfully, no. And we have several of our club meetings here throughout the year. And, of course, we have field day out here. And we're really glad to have this facility. It's air-conditioned, it's large, and usually there's a lot of room for us to add antennas and, you know, add temporary antennas. I mean, we're even running some through the window.
That is awesome, but it's only holding up a delta loop.
There's a kind of a ladder line type dipole hanging off the tower out there. Is that a permanent ham antenna, or is that for field day?
That one, some of the hams work to install that on Alamance County's existing tower. So that ladder line antenna is a permanent antenna, but most of the others around that we have set up here are temporary.
Yeah. Are you using that today? I guess you would. Why not?
Yeah, we've got that. We're using that in our sideband station down the hall.
Okay. Is that station down there, is that just set up in an office, or is there a permanent ham station here?
There's actually a permanent ham station. When shortly after the workers at the Alamance Fire Marshal Office got their licenses, they said, hey, we want to put in a station, and we've got, you know, this much money that we can put to it. So several of the members of the club got together and worked to determine what would be the best fit for an EOC. So we ended up putting in two VHF UHF transceivers, and we've got an HF rig in there, and we've also got a couple TNC units for, you know, computer-to-computer communication.
Yeah, North Carolina has gone pretty big on Winlink, mm-hmm, as a data communication maintained by the hams for state emergency management. Does this county have a Winlink connection?
We do. All of the computers that we have, or I should say the computer we have in the office where the sideband station is, the ham radio station, does have you know, Winlink capabilities, and we've got interfacing to the radios. So, you know, if we need to, we can and have used Winlink in the past.
Yeah. Are you much of a Winlink expert at this point? Have you played with it?
I've played with it. I've sent quite a handful of messages. I probably wouldn't go so far as to call myself an expert, but I can certainly navigate the system.
Yeah, I understand that North Carolina hams do their Winlink on Mars frequencies.
Some hams that also have Mars licenses do.
Oh, wait, that's you, isn't it?
Oh, yes. Ah, the memories of 2013 field day when, I remember.
Wait,
that
was 2013? That was you, right?
Yes, that was me.
In 2013?
Yes.
This is 2016. That's only 3 years.
Yeah.
You've gone from 12 years old to 35. What happened?
I attribute that to my parents. They fed me, and they watered me, and they gave me plenty of sunshine. Okay.
All right. So we were talking WinLink on Mars. Is it a Mars setup here or on the ham frequencies?
It is. We do have a Mars setup, yeah. But I think more often than not, we tend to use the ham frequencies. Yeah.
People should understand why they go to Mars.
Well,
it's not exactly the right expression, isn't it? Why they use Mars frequencies?
It'd be funny to use Mars if we ever made it to Mars.
Yeah.
Then that would
Mars on a Mars station on Mars.
That would be kind of exciting.
I think if you add one more Mars in there, somewhere the universe implodes. So maybe we should.
Or everybody gets M&Ms. One of the two.
Perfect. I'm going to go for that. So why Mars frequencies?
Well, generally, Mars is somewhat being phased out, or at least the HF frequencies are being less used by the military, and my understanding is that they're more available to radio amateurs who often have to face, you know, slightly more congested band space than Mars users do.
Yeah, you're being kind. There's no QRM on the Mars channels.
True.
On the ham channels, you can get blasted off.
I
don't know if it happens all that much, but the Mars channels is QRM free.
Thankfully.
QRN is another story.
Yeah.
But you're not going to find other stations kind of just sliding in right next to you on a Mars frequency. It makes a lot of sense to use that.
Yeah, it does.
So until everyone follows what I want to do, which is to channelize all of ham radio. You ever heard me talk about that?
I have. It might work.
Yeah, no, I don't think so.
Might. Maybe.
No, I don't think so.
Then you'll have somebody violate it, but.
Well, yeah. I don't think we're going to do that. All right, so I think we're done. I'm going to go out and shoot some B-roll, and we'll show everybody what you got going on here. Maybe I'll. Your young fella disappeared.
Yeah.
He bailed.
Yeah, he had to.
He had to go do his homework. So I'll look for you guys when I get back on the road. You have fun. And,
thank you.
Are you going to keep on growing? How old are you now?
16. Ask me the same question in 4 months, and I'll be 17.
Yeah, so you got a couple more years to grow, I guess.
Yeah, got a couple more. I inherit my height from my grandfather. He was 6'4", 6'5", if I'm not mistaken.
Okay, so I'm going to have to bring a taller tripod.
Yeah, I'll be somewhere up here.
All right, good seeing you again, Chris.
Good seeing you, too.
Awesome job.
Thank you.
The kid makes me feel old. Thank you, Chris, and thank you, Dwayne. And by the way, they did invite me to stay for dinner, and I would have, but I had plans with Cindy that night. So, you know, it wasn't easy to say no, not with those stakes. So thanks to all you guys at the Alamance Amateur Radio Club and Okra and DFMA, and good luck in the contest. So while you guys were watching that, I got a Skype call from my wife, Cindy, KD4ACW. Cindy is out in Utah this week. So I'm a bachelor. I also picked up a co-host. Here's the bear. So I got a co-host on my lap. I got the bear, and I've got Cindy on the phone, and she is at Best Friends. Speaking of cats, she's at Best Friends Animal. What is it? Best Friends Animal. What, Cindy?
Sanctuary.
Okay. And so this is what she is doing. This is just one of the outside rooms where the cats live. And show me a cat, because all we're seeing right now is, yeah. Ah, there's a cutie pie. Let me dial down my picture brightness. There we go. Okay, so how's it going out there? You're going to be out there for the week, right?
Yep, coming back Sunday. So out here every day, helping out in cat world, cleaning, loving on cats.
And having a wonderful time.
And having a wonderful time, yeah.
All right.
It's been great.
I got to go finish this Ham Radio Now episode. I will talk to you later tonight.
All right.
Love you, sweetie pie.
Love you, baby. Bye, baby.
Bye-bye. There we go. I didn't do my phone doesn't do the Skype bleep thing. I don't know why. All right. So tell you what, let's go on back to Hillsboro, and we'll spend some quality time with Bruce N1LN on 40 meter CW. I'm going to do my best to narrate what's happening. I've got a cheat sheet
Or there's no way that I would be keeping up with this. So, back to Hillsboro. And as we tune in, Bruce is listening to the end of a contact. That's QSL, ES, that's CW for AND, TNX, thanks, DE, N8RC, FD. That's the way you indicate you're calling CQ without saying CQ again. And he switched antennas, and there's a little FD in there. Bruce hasn't changed frequency, but the pitch was different. It is 84V, and I can't tell if he's in a contact or not, and Bruce can't either. So he just calls, drops in the W4EZ a few more times, just to see. And it is clearer now that 84V is calling CQ, although we never heard of CQ, just the FD. But it's also clear that he's not hearing W4EZ. So Bruce tunes on. And he tunes in N8LC, who is calling CQ, a long CQ. He doesn't answer Bruce's first call. And if you listen carefully, the N8LC signal is getting intermittently masked with noise. Bruce thinks that's from the W4EZ digital station, but he can't be sure. Anyway, no luck with N8LC, so Bruce tunes on. He's following the three tries and move on procedure. He finds K8LRG calling CQ. And this time he gets an answer amid that intermittent hash. K8LRG is 4A in VA, Virginia. TU, thank you, and Bruce tunes on. So wham bam. There are two stations on top of each other here. I lost one call sign in the hash, but Bruce is going after the higher pitch signal anyway. It's a VE3MIS. So the two signals on top of each other are just one too many, and Bruce tunes on and finds N4RLD more in the clear. And success. N4RLD is 1D, that's a home station on commercial mains power, and he is in Georgia. And Bruce tunes away as N4RLD is sending QSL. He's not going to wait around for that, not wasting time. He tunes in just as K9OR is finishing a contact. AGN, again, 3A, WPA, TU, K9OR, FD. And that is Bruce's cue to call.
Working?
Once.
The computer's not keying the rig.
Twice. And he hears AGN again. So K9OR heard something, but he couldn't make it out, so he sends AGN. He could have just sent a question mark, but he sends AGN. Bruce sends W4EZ a few times, but that's no go. K9OR starts calling CQ, and Bruce moves on to call K9DTU, and he talks to the other guys in the van about the noise he thinks he's hearing from the digital station.
40-meter digital digi's on.
He's not hooked up yet.
Really?
Yeah. No, I just left there. I had to pull my rig out. He had
K9 DTU had answered someone else, and Bruce called him again when he was done. And tries to pull his reply out of that hash. He completes the contact, and K9 DTU moves on, but Bruce realizes he wasn't quite sure about K9 DTU's class, so he manually sends CLASS ? He gets 2B in response. Bruce may have been hoping that K9 DTU would make another contact quickly so he could copy the class from that exchange, but nobody answered K9 DTU's next CQ, Bruce had to ask. So next, Bruce tunes in W8AWE. You don't hear the CQ, but the FD at the end is a clue that this is a CQ call. No answer. And it seems W8AWE has stalled out. They're not responding to anyone, so Bruce moves on. He finds what sounds like a clear spot and sends QRL ? That means, is this frequency in use? I'm going to guess that Bruce did that because he was on camera. Most field day stations would just launch into their CQ. QRM is an expected thing on field day. If you pick a spot that turns out to be busy, you just move. On phone, some aggressive ops may try to muscle their competition off the frequency. And if the band is super crowded, you might not have much choice than to fight it out. On CW, I don't know. It's more civilized, I'm told. maybe even on field day. How you doing, Bear? So anyway, Bruce calls CQ, and now remember, at 5 watts, that's kind of a low percentage thing, but once in a while, you got to try, and it pays off. K8AJS responds to the very first CQ. Bruce sends his class and section, 8ANC. K8AJS responds with 2EOH, Ohio, but first he resends W4EZ's call sign. That's not really necessary unless he was not sure he had the call sign correct. And then it should have been followed by a ? Otherwise, it just wastes time. But field day operators are not all razor-sharp contesters. And a lot of them don't really want to be. So they'll send extra stuff. It happens more on phone than CW. But some operators just they're kind of relaxing and they don't mind wasting a little time. In fact, they have heard other operators do that with all the extra words and stuff, and they consider that to be the correct operating procedure. It's not until they take Contest University at Dayton that they discover they've been wasting a little bit of time. And real serious contest operators might get a little bit irritated about it, even at field day. Bruce moves on to more CQs. It's all automatic, sent by his computer. He doesn't even have to push a button very often. It'll send a bunch of CQs and wait in between. And even if it's a low percentage, you have to call CQ some, because there's a lot of other stations out there doing search and pounce, and if you never CQ, you're never going to work them. It takes a while, but finally W9FEZ responds. He sends his call sign twice. It's a little time waster unless you think the station you're calling is going to have a hard time pulling you out of the congestion or the noise. He messes up sending his class, so he sends it twice correctly, 2AIN. And Bruce is back to sending CQ again. And again. And again. want to confess that I had some help copying the call signs during that segment. No, not from Jeff, AC4ZO, my CW whiz friend. It was from my video editing program, Premiere Pro. Here's what the audio track looks like when I zoom in. You can see the code right there on the track, as long as there's not a lot of noise. And if you're an audio listener to the show, it shows up as little bumps on the timeline. Okay, we're going to leave Bruce and move on to the phone operation. And I am actually kind of conflicted about putting this into the program. This young lady is Greta Lamb, KM4LCW. We talked to her grandfather, Wilson, a couple of minutes ago. And this is her dad, KM4DNU. And that's Brian, K5QZI, sitting next to Greta doing the logging. If I've done the math right, Greta is 12 or maybe 13 years old, and she's been a ham for just over a year. Although she's been around ham radio for a lot longer. In fact, if you check out her QRZ profile, you will see that she is a fourth generation ham. Wilson's W4BOH call sign originally belonged to his father, Greta's great-grandfather, so it's in her blood. Greta also says she is animal crazy. She's got 6 chickens, 3 turtles, a cat, a snake, and a dog, and given the snake, I think she still has the cat. She might want to check. Greta is operating 40-meter phone, and as we said, 5 watts on phone, especially on 40 and 80, can be brutal. If 15 or 10 meters is hot, you can do just fine with 5 watts. They're quiet bands, and those signals really get out. But on 40 and 80, you're going to be down in the mud no matter what. And this field day, 10 and 15 were not hot. They weren't even lukewarm. So Greta is struggling on 40. And while I'm generally dedicated to the idea of telling it like it is on this show, you see me do that quite a bit, if I'm going to show young hams, I really want to show them succeeding. And this time I can't, because Greta was not making a lot of contacts. Okay, she wasn't making any contacts. And she was making a lot of rookie mistakes. So she is trying hard. She is putting in maximum effort. She is all heart and enthusiasm and energy and more than a little frustration. And it all plays out on her face and in her voice. So I want you to see it. And I'm pretty sure she'll be okay with it. She's a very mature young lady. At the risk of looking like I'm beating her up, I am also going to point out some of the things that don't go quite right. Oh, I'm so sorry, Greta. I want to do this and I don't want to do it. I'll tell you what, maybe you're a new ham. Maybe you're 13 or 30 or 70. Maybe you just got through field day and maybe your experience didn't go so great either. Or maybe you were even too scared to even try. So it might help to watch someone else going through the meat grinder, and you'll see that you're not the only one. Okay, that's going to be my rationalization. So, sorry, Greta. Let's take a look.
And class, please.
We actually get started with Joe Simpson, K4SAR, completing a contact on 15 meters.
Alpha in North Carolina, November Charlie, QSL.
And you can see me puttering around and trying to find a place to shoot with camera B in that tiny trailer.
Roger, roger. 8 Alpha, North Carolina.
By the way, the beam they're using for 15 is actually the antenna that was going up over Dave Snyder's head during his interview. Those radials on the end made me think it was the satellite antenna, but I think it's just an unusual design for a compact beam. As Joe tunes across the band, there's nobody else on 15, so they decide to switch to 40, which was full of signals, and put Greta in the driver's seat. She begins with search and pounce, and tunes in this contact in progress.
Charlie, Papa.
which finishes up and go.
KM4W4EZ.
Oops. Well, we've all done that.
Whiskey 4, easy.
Still a little unsteady, so watch her lock it in. But she's missing the cues that WA2CP is standing by for calls. That was it. Picking those cues out of the din on field day comes with practice. She gets the next one.
I can work these pileups pretty
good. Whiskey 4.
And a little confusion as WA2CP hears a Zulu.
Whiskey 4, Echo Zulu.
Was that Whiskey 1, Foxtrot Zulu? Not very close, but worth a try.
Okay, Whiskey 1, Foxtrot Zulu.
But nope, it's Whiskey 1, Foxtrot Zulu for sure. Now, an experienced operator would catch that as being someone else, but Greta's still thinking that WA2CP copied her call wrong.
He was hearing a Foxtrot Zulu. He really was hearing a Foxtrot Zulu.
Oh.
Right,
well.
Moving on, I think Greta is settling herself down as she misses a couple of cues to call Kilo 8 Mike Uniform. When she's got him clearly, she calls. And it gets interesting again.
Whiskey 4, Echo Zulu.
Whiskey 4, Juliet, Juliet, maybe, is that correct?
Negative, Whiskey 4, Echo Zulu. Whiskey 4, Echo Zulu, W4EZ.
I'm kind of weak here. Give me, call again, please. Call again.
Whiskey 4, Echo Zulu. Whiskey 4, Echo Zulu.
And he's a Duke.
Yeah. Sorry, Duke. There you go.
So awkward. But since he wasn't copying her very well, it was going to be hard to make a better exit. So I'll give her a pass on that quick shuffle.
So I haven't hit anybody.
Next, Brian suggests trying to run, calling CQ.
This sounds like a somewhat open frequency.
Yeah, good idea. Should ask the abandoned.
CQ field day, CQ.
I think Greta was starting to ask if she should see if the frequency is in use, but Brian takes the more aggressive tactic that I was suggesting back in the CW segment. So she does.
CQ field day, W4EZ, W4EZ, CQ field day, CQ field day. W4EZ,
on her second call, she reverses the CQ and the call sign. Now, there's no rule about this. The only reason to stick with the standard protocol, CQ first, call sign second, is that that's what others will be expecting to hear. You don't want to make them try to figure out what you're doing.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, CQ, CQ, field day, CQ, field day, CQ, field day, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu.
So when it became clear to me that Greta was stuck in the backward mode, I gave her a nudge.
Start with the CQ. Say CQ first.
Okay, okay. CQ, field day, CQ, field day, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, calling CQ, field day. Echo Zulu, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, CQ field day, CQ field day, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, calling CQ field day. Whiskey 4, CQ field day, CQ field day, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, calling CQ field day. Whiskey 4 Echo.
Okay, CQ with 5 watts is iffy, and it's sounding like somebody else might be just a little too close to her frequency. With 100 watts, I might have stood my ground. With just 5, I think I might have tuned him in and made the contact.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day. Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, calling CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day. Oh, rats. CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day, CQ Field Day. Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, CQ Field Day.
Okay, I loved that.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, calling CQ Field Day.
So Greta gives up and tunes up. And they're kind of slow. While we're waiting, Brian adjusts the receiver, DSP, or maybe the bandwidth, or both. It makes a big difference.
All right, thank you for taking with us to Lima Station.
But he had someone waiting in the wings, the Lima Station.
The other station that was calling, come again.
Who had fallen asleep for a minute.
Okay, all we got was Lima. All we got was Ian. Try again, please, again.
The waiting is killing me. This is all kind of messy. Well, typically messy, I'm afraid. And you know, we've never gotten this guy's call sign.
Kilo at the beginning. One more time, please.
And it gets messier.
Okay, Kilo Juliet 4, Echo Lima Echo. Thank you. 3 Alpha, Illinois. 3 Alpha, Illinois.
So I'm thinking that guy's gone. He said thanks. And when everything seems to stall, and you're pretty sure somebody needs a kickstart, I say give him a call.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu.
Yeah, KJ4, ELE, sorry, no contact.
And I'm wrong. KJ4 LEL is back. The other station has his call sign wrong again, and they're doubling. Could it get any worse? So Greta calls, and the guy hears her and asks her to stand by while he works someone else.
Charlie Alpha Delta, thanks. 3 Alpha, Illinois.
But he forgot about us and calls QRZ. At least we have his call sign now, K9OR.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu.
Greta's missing the cues again and needs a little nudge.
Okay, November India, November 0, India, Illinois.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu.
And yes, it can get messier. If somebody's strong just off frequency and somebody's tuning up, in other words, a typical field day. But Greta doesn't give up.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu.
So when the station you're calling isn't answering you, and he isn't answering anybody else, that's a pretty good clue that he's not hearing you.
Whiskey 4, Echo Zulu. Whiskey 4, Echo Zulu.
I had to wrap up and get down the road. So while Greta wasn't giving up, I did. But as soon as I shut the camera off, K9OR came back to Greta. So I grabbed the B camera and got what I could.
November Charlie.
Oh, come
eight
on. Now. Give the kid
North
a break.
W4 Echo Zulu.
Okay, this might be a costly mistake. K9OR had the W4EZ call sign, and he's only getting bits and pieces of that 5-watt signal. But Greta spends precious time repeating Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu instead of repeating the class and section.
Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, Whiskey 4 Echo Zulu, W4EZ. We are 8 Alpha, 8 Alpha.
On the plus side, she also repeats 8A November Charlie several times.
North Carolina November Charlie, NC.
Oh, this is tough. Did he send a Roger or did he just give up? There's no way to tell. All right, well, like I say, sorry, Greta. I hope it doesn't come off like I'm picking on you. I really just want people to see what this is really like. I can see the QRZ posts now, though. Give the kid a break. She's only 13. But watching you operate, pretty sure you can take it. Pretty sure. And if you like this stuff, Greta, pretty soon you're going to be the pro, and you're going to be teaching people how to do this at Contest University. Okay, it's time to go. But one more last thing. I got this email from Dave Wright, W9RIT, and he's pointing me to this website of another field day operation, some folks down in Florida, W4OT, operating with a balloon antenna, and, well, listen to what they recorded.
KN4AQ from Whiskey 4, Oscar Tango. Please copy my 3 Alpha South Florida. That's 3 Alpha South Florida. QSL.
Roger, 1 Charlie North Carolina.
Thank you. I copy your 1 Charlie North Carolina. Good luck in the contest in 73 from Whiskey 4, Oscar Tango. QRZ Field Day.
So, yes, I did operate mobile between the field day sites that I visited. Dave, thank you for catching that little contact and pointing it out to me. I had hoped to do another on-the-road segment for all the big stuff. Hang on. Come on up here, Bear. There we go. Settle in. Let go of my cord. Okay. Comes and goes. So I was going to do an on-the-road segment and show you my field day operating, but again, with the truncated field day video operation, I decided not to do that. Really didn't have time to set it all up. It takes about an hour or so to get all the video stuff and audio stuff set up in there. So I'm glad those guys heard me and got to at least play a little bit of it, and me being very contest-like on my operation. What I do, since I'm not logging driving solo and I can't log, I'll pick a band, and I will start at the bottom of the band, and I'll work a station, and surprisingly effective for mobile, and you heard my signal, it's pretty good. Work a station, and then tune up to a kilohertz and a half, and wait till I hear some activity, and work the next station, and then move my way up the band. If it's too congested, or I don't get through after a few calls, I'll move on to the next station. Surprisingly able to work stations that don't seem all that strong. And they're still able to hear me, even from a mobile. But since I'm not logging, I can't go back across the band and try to pick up stations I might have missed, because I'll end up being a dupe for a lot of people and, you know, being an idiot. So that's what I did. I was having a good time. Dave mentioned the PayPal option and wishing that it were still there. And, well, yay, I have figured out how to add it to the Ham Radio Now website. And so let's click to enter. And we'll go to the contribute page. And so there's the Patreon, there's the credit card, and now there's the PayPal as a one-time option. Figured out how to do that just before I started putting this program together. So you can select the amount that you want. I stuck $100 in there. It wasn't, it wasn't totally as a joke, but it was, I wasn't expecting a lot of that. And it, well, I haven't gotten a lot of it, but I've gotten a lot more than I thought. So you guys are awesome. If you want something that's a little bit different, you can, or if you want more than $100, when you get to the, I don't see the button. Still got me there, but the button didn't show up. I have to figure out why. You can change the quantity. That will let you configure whatever payment you want in whatever amount you want. Let me remove that. Go back here, and you can type stuff in this box. I want to get your call sign. Oh, it's remembering the last thing that I put in. And as you type it, it scrolls off to the side, but it remembers that, but it doesn't show the button. Not sure what the problem is with the button. I'll go find that and fix it. So put in your call sign, and you can type a few more things as well. So, hooray, the PayPal is gone. Not for subscriptions. If you want to do a subscription, do the Patreon. But for a one-time thing. Some folks have preferred using PayPal to the other thing, which is just a generic, this other thing, this credit card one-time thing. It's just a generic credit card merchant. It's called Stripe. I'm not sure that you ever see the Stripe thing, but that's what that was. Some folks felt comfortable or wanted to pay from their PayPal account rather than a credit card. So that's available. Once again, one more thing. You watched me wear the Ham Radio Now t-shirt. And if you're watching during my interview with Dave, you saw the sweat building up on it progressively as we stood out there in the sun. So I've also finally gotten the Ham Radio Now stuff on the website under a swag button. Let's see if these pictures show up. Okay, well, good. Those did. Something worked. So they got hoodies. They've got Ham Radio Now mugs. That's this mug that's sitting back there. The picture here looks a little weird, just so they could show the whole logo, because otherwise it, try not to drop it. It wraps around the mug, so you can't see the whole thing all at once. So a little bit of swag. It comes from these guys at hamshirts.com from Tom. And I haven't promoted that a whole lot. Lots of other shows promote their swag a whole lot more. But if you're interested in having something that nobody else in your radio club has got, and will cause a lot of people to ask you questions like, what is that all about? Then stop by here, hamshirts.com, or the Ham Radio Now button where it says swag. And he's got lots of other stuff, some generic stuff, and then he can make things custom for you or for your organization, your radio club, or whatever. So, the Ham Radio Now t-shirt. Get one at a website near you. I think we're done. Covered the contributions and stuff. So, Arvin, your job here is done as well. We'll give you the hamradionow.tv website for the contribution thing just to fill in down there at the bottom. And that is it for this episode, this epic, highly edited episode of Ham Radio Now. Thanks for waiting for it. I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73. See you next time. Yes, over and out.